Hi guys, my name is Li Karlsén and I'm a Molchanovs freediving instructor based in Sweden. And I'm also the founder of Freedivenordic, that's a freediving school based here in Stockholm. And today we're going to not deep dive into the nutrition for freedivers, but more look into the benefits of a whole food plant-based diet. The purpose of this webinar is to talk about the benefits of a whole food plant-based diet. And this diet is not to be regarded as like specific medical advice, but more in general information terms in how you can eat in order to resource your body in the best possible way. And behind the camera, I have my amazing brother, Linus, who is also a basic freediver, but he specializes in and nutrition for the plant-based diet, as he is a certified nutritionist. In Swedish, we have a thing called helhetshälsa, and that would translate into whole health or holistic health, whereas holistic is a bit of a worn-out term, isn't it? But what it means is that nutrition is just one part of it, whereas you have sleep, you have recovery, and you have movement, and then you also have nutrition. There's a lot of studies that shows that you should eat the main bulk of your energy in the morning, because that's where you have the highest metabolism. And there's an old saying that goes that you should eat like a queen for breakfast, like a princess for lunch, and as a beggar for dinner. So the dinner shouldn't be seen as the main meal of the day, but rather the breakfast. Eating dinner before 7 p.m. is a really good thing, as well as staying away from bulky, empty calories later at night. This means that when you wake up in the morning, when you're doing your dry static or if you're going to the pool, you have an empty stomach, but you're still full with energy. With that said, I would like to make a distinction between the vegan diet and the plant-based diet. The vegan diet is based on moral and ethical principles, whereas the plant-based diet is based on nutritional science. A plant-based diet can be regarded as a proactive protection against chronic diseases, as they are very high in the amount of nutrients to calorie ratio. They are rich in fiber, vitamins, minerals, antioxidants, and phytonutrients. They are also devoid of added sugar and more often have a more favorable composition of fatty acids compared to many of the animal and processed products that we consume daily. They also don't contain any cholesterol at all. So what matters on a large scale is dietary patterns and what we consume day in and day out. If you sometimes sleep and eat something that's not really beneficial for you, and that really doesn't mean that the next meal couldn't be better and that you somehow fail. So start off where you are now at your own pace and find out what actually works for you. So, to illustrate the building blocks of a plant-based diet, we will use a triangle that consists of four parts. The first level of the triangle is the base, and it's divided into vegetables and fruits. The second level consists of whole grains, and the third part is leafy greens, vegetables and legumes, and the fourth and last level consists of high-fat whole food such as avocados, nuts, seeds and vegetable oils, etc. For some athletes, there's another level to this pyramid that we will talk about later on. So, if we break it down and start at the bottom of the pyramid, we have vegetables such as asparagus, beetroot, carrot, garlic, mushrooms, pumpkin, squash, sweet potato and tomatoes that are all have like a great nutritional profile, but in various ways. Cruciferous vegetables also fit into that bottom level of the pyramid and should be consumed on a daily basis. One serving per day is recommended as a minimum amount. Examples of some cruciferous vegetables are cabbage, broccoli, Brussels sprouts, cauliflower, radish, bok choy and watercress. The other part of the bottom level in the pyramid are fruits and berries. We all heard that an apple a day keeps the doctor away, right? So why not more? Fruits are a great snack and are more or less available all over the world. try to get a good variation of different types of fruits and find one that you prefer. So what about berries? They're really Mother Nature's own sweets and are packed with antioxidants. It's recommended that you consume at least one serving a day, which roughly translates into a handful of berries. That's just a minimum amount of what you're obviously free to eat as much as you please. And frozen berries are available all year round and are almost equal to the fresh berry nutritional one. On the second level of the pyramid, we have whole grains. That's a great source of energy, protein, fiber, and also micronutrients. Some examples are oats, barley, rye, brown rice, wild rice, buckwheat, quinoa, and whole grain pasta. Try to consume at least 3 servings with whole grains per day. Moving further up in the pyramid, we have the third level. We have legumes and leafy vegetables. Legumes are a great source of fiber, protein, and micronutrients, and you should aim for at least 3 servings a day, which is approximately 400 grams. Some examples of legumes are black beans, white beans, kidney beans, chickpeas, tempeh, edamame, and lentils, just to name a few. The real powerhouse of nutritional content is found in dark green leafy vegetables, such as kale, spinach, mangoes, and arugula. They all have a very high nutrition to calorie ratio and should definitely be consumed on a daily basis. You can never get enough of these, so try to find a way to implement them into your diet just as much as possible. And try to get at least of 2 servings of cruciferous leafy vegetables per day. The final level of the pyramid consists of high-fat whole food, such as nuts, seeds, vegetable oils, etc. Nuts and seeds, a handful of mixed nuts and seeds a day is a really, really good starting point. An example of this is hazelnut, cashews, almonds, peanuts, whale nuts, Brazil nuts, macadamia, and chia seeds. And just to be clear, whale nuts are not nuts from whales, it's walnuts. Other than that, I would also recommend that you consume at least 1 to 2 tablespoons of ground flax seeds on a daily basis for the essential fatty acids and fiber content that they will provide. It can also be mentioned that there's a big difference in being full from consuming volumes opposed to being full from consuming nutritious food. Compare a large bowl of pasta with a large bowl of salad. One is high on energy but low on nutrients, and the other one is low on energy but very high in nutrients. So which one is the best? Well, that's depending on what you want to do, of course, since you both need energy to perform, but also micronutrients and other components in order to thrive. Moving on to the more practical and fun stuff, we've been talking a lot about the plant-based diet. So I will give you some examples of what these modules really are and how you can use them in the kitchen. So we'll start with my favorite meal of the day, breakfast. When we talk about breakfast as a meal, there are certain components that we should focus on. You can view breakfast as consisting of interchangeable modules where the nutritional content and the nutritional profile is about the same, but the flavor and the diversity of the dish is varied. And for me, the breakfast is the favorite dish, as I mentioned before, especially after a freediving session when you can turn it into a brunch. Since breakfast is the first meal of the day, it's quite natural that we want energy, preferably in the form of both slow-acting and medium-acting carbohydrates that complement each other, but also vitamins, minerals, healthy fats, antioxidants, phytonutrients, and protein. An illustration of this could be a smoothie bowl, overnight oats, or porridge, which are quite similar in their layout and easily modified. So, when making a smoothie bowl, I prefer using bananas, dates, a handful of oats, handful of spinach, berries, and 1 to 2 tablespoons of ground flax seeds. Other options could include dried apricots, dates, or agave syrup, cacao powder, cinnamon, saffron, turmeric, protein powders, and so-called superfoods, etc. Another favorite of mine is the overnight oats, and it's super easy if I go traveling to always carry with me just oats, flax seeds, and chia seeds. So I prepare this where I have a jar in the fridge with some frozen berries. It's blueberries and raspberries, and then there's flax seeds, chia seeds, and some oats. Environment where you can't always choose what you want to eat, it can be somewhat problematic to make sure that you actually get everything that you need. Therefore, it's extra important to focus on the breakfast. Lunch is a perfect opportunity to create nutritious and colorful meals to meet your needs throughout the day. And like breakfast, you can regard lunch as being made up of different modules where nutritional content is about the same, but the taste and type of food is also interchangeable. An example of a setup could be a so-called Buddha bowl, where the base usually consists of a carbohydrate source like quinoa, amaranth, buckwheat, bulgur, brown rice, etc. A protein source, soybeans, chickpeas, white beans, lentils, tofu or tempeh. And some cruciferous vegetables, such as broccoli, Brussels sprouts, kale, and red cabbage. You can top up with some more vegetables that you like, and also some nuts and seeds to finish up with a plant-based dressing. Like we mentioned earlier, the dinner should preferably not be regarded as the main dish of the day, but rather as a complement to what you've been consuming earlier. Earlier in the video, I mentioned another level in the pyramid that can be suitable for some individuals depending on their goals and eating habits. We have all heard about so-called superfoods before, where superfood can be everything from spirulina to chlorella, maca, moringa, acai berries, or just good old goji berries. These foods, alongside supplements, can be seen as the final touch of an already well-balanced and sustainable eating habit. But what about coffee then? To caffeine or not to caffeine? Well, caffeine can cause a short but dramatic increase of your blood pressure, even if you don't have a high blood pressure. And that's, generally speaking, nothing that a freediver would like, right? So, strictly freediving performance-wise, there's nothing in coffee that would benefit you, except maybe the psychological effect of enjoying your coffee after a nice PB dive. Tea, on the other hand, is something else. Studies have shown that the amino acid L-theanine found in green tea leaves promotes a state of alert relaxation. Consumption of L-theanine increases the level of alpha wave in the brain and enables a focused calm without drowsiness. So thank you guys very much for listening. I hope you all learned something new that you can adapt into your life and that you feel that you're willing to try out. And remember that nutrition is just one bit of the whole or complete health. So don't be afraid to adapt what's available for you and explore new stuff. Just as you're exploring your body when you go freediving, both mentally and physically. And one meal can be seen as one session of freediving. It's just one small part of the whole of your goals and what you're aiming for. Take care, bye bye.